Okay, so we solved the problem. We can start. So this afternoon we talk about the second major system, the coolant system. I will also refer mostly to the IAEA safety standards, and I will address some design aspects and some safety assessment aspects, just to be to cover these items in these topics in 1 hour and a half. So the presentation will be the reactor coolant system associated systems. So that means the coolant system and all other fluid systems that are connected to this system, the function and the extent of the reactor coolant system and associated systems, the general concepts of this system for PWR and BWR. You understand, these systems are significantly different, switching from one technology to another. And then I will recall the specific requirements that are in SSR2/1 for these systems. This is the safety guide that currently we have, and it's called NSG 1.9, was published in 2004, and now is under revision to make the new safety guide consistent with the latest requirement, SSR2/1, because this safety guide was prepared when the old requirement, NSR1, were in place. So what are the functions? Let's always starting from the function and then going down to the system and components. The function of the reactor coolant system and associated system is first to contain the coolant. Because if you don't contain the coolant, you cannot cool. But this is a process function. But we have to contain the coolant also because the coolant can be activated and contain some radioactive material. So it is a barrier for the confinement of the fission product. So this is a very important function. Then we have to remove the heat from the core and from the components in all plant states that we are considered in the design. Then we have to transfer the heat, that we remove the core, to the ultimated sink. And this comes through different steps. It's a rather complex chain. It's not just one heat exchanger. And we have to maintain the specified physical and chemical characteristic of the coolant. Of course, when you're talking about physical characteristic, that means the temperature, that means the pressure, and when you're talking about chemical or the chemical additive that are there, that the water should be particularly pure, and there are some addition chemical products like the boron oxide and so on. So we have to control the chemistry and physics of the coolant. So these are the function of this complex set of system that we call system associated to the main coolant system. So what are the main components then of this RCS-AES? First is the reactor coolant system, known as RCS. This is quite a known acronym. Then we have the system for the residual heat removal. That can be system for normal operation and system for accident. It depends on the design. Some of the system can be partially used for both situations. In other design, they are completely separated. And that is really in agreement with the latest interpretation of defense in depth. Each plant state should have the dedicated systems and cooling systems. Then we have the chemistry, inventory, and the reactivity control systems, and finally, ultimated sink. When we say automated sync, at least in the terminology of the agency, the automated sync is the final means. So it means the air, the water, this is the automated sink. So it can be either the atmosphere or the water in the ocean or in the river. But when we talk, normally when we talk about automated sink, we mean also the interfacing system with the sea or with the air. So the last part of the cooling chain that really is exchanging heat with the water or with the air. So this is the automated sink. But as a definition of the agency, automated sink means water or air. It's not a system. So we can have a variety of drawings showing this, the cooling system for different kind of reactors. And if you go on even on the internet, you can find brochure for many reactors, and you can have plenty of these beautiful full of colors pictures with all the explanations. So I refer very quickly to two or three drawings that we have in the safety guide, because they are sufficient to indicate the major systems that we have. So this is the typical for a PWR. We can see the reactor coolant system. Then I have I put some colors on the specific piping so we can individuate the system more clearly. Then here you can see the reactor pressure vessel, then the steam generators, and then the turbine, the condenser, and closing the cycle. And then here we have the emergency core cooling systems with the tank. Here we have the passive system. And then here we have two lines. One is for high pressure and low pressure pumps, so to inject water in different conditions. And then we have the automated sink for the residual heat removal system, and this is for the other system. So this is then here we have the pressurizer with the safety valves and so on. So these are the major typical components of a PWR. Of course, you understand that in reality, the situation is much more complex. If you see real drawings with real piping and valves and the pumps that you have in a thing, you can fill a page, and it's quite difficult to, it takes some time to understand all the interconnections and all the functions. But this is sufficient, I mean, for our purpose. So I use this, and an equivalent that also we have for the BWR. Also here you can see the pressure, the pressure vessel, the depressurization system, turbine, and the main cycle, and then the ECCS and the automated sink with the two different cooling chain. This is just to give an idea of how many systems are in this family. This is another representation for another kind of reactor. This is for a CANDU reactor, the Colful. This is a little, I think probably you are familiar with this concept. There is no typical pressure vessel, but the core is located inside horizontal tubes, and everything is immersed in a big tank of heavy water that acts as a moderator. And then for the rest is very similar to a PWR. We have a steam generator, pressurizer, primary pump, and then the steam goes to the turbine. Here is the coolant system of a typical VVR. It's a Russian design. And that is there is a particular feature on this reactor, because the steam generators are horizontal. And practically is the only one that I know that using this solution, or the big nuclear power plant. and this is Russian technology, while in the Western technology, all reactors have, all nuclear power plants have vertical steam generators. So these are, so there are very different technical solutions, and all of them work quite well. So what are the things to consider for the design of all these systems? First, the safety function they have to perform in different plant state. We never get tired to repeat this fundamental concept. Then what are the postulated initiating events they have to deal with? The safety classification and the associated design and fabrication codes. This is what we talked about this morning. Then the loads and the loads combination that can affect this the design of these systems. Then the protection against external hazard. Typical example is the seismic. The protection against internal hazard. We have the, we mentioned yesterday what these internal hazards are. Then the design criteria, for example, the single failure criteria and others. The environmental conditions in which this equipment have to work in normal states and also during the accidents that we are considering our design. And the selection of materials, and then requirement for testing, inspection, and maintenance. So all this should be clearly in mind to the designer to conceive and design in detail these systems. So now let's go to limit our discussion to the reactor coolant system. The what are the functions of this specific system? First, to transfer the heat from the reactor to the steam generators in the PWR or directly to the turbine in a BWR. Maintain the pressure of the coolant within specified limits. Contain the coolant, providing an effective barrier to the release of reactive material and keeping the integrity of the pressure boundary. So these are the main function of this system, reactor coolant system. Here are the major components of the reactor coolant system. And you can see here the list of the, because they are very close, this button here. This, the main components are reactor vessel, and in case of the PWR, steam generator, the primary side that is very important. Only the primary side is part of the coolant system. This is important because the safety class can be different from the tubes that inside the steam generator are part of the primary coolant and the shell of the steam generator that is part of the secondary. So that is something very important also to remember. Then the reactor coolant pump, the pressurizer, the piping, the hot leg, cold leg, and surge line, the overpressure protection system, and the depressurization system. We will discuss some of these, not all of them, because if you have discussed each of these components in detail, really, we take takes much more time. So you can see here a typical configuration of a four-loop reactor coolant system. For loop, you see there are four steam generators and four primary coolant pumps. Here you see the vessel, and this is the pressurizer connected to one line of the primary coolant circuit, just like this, you can see. So this is a typical configuration that is common to many plants. What can change is the number of loops. We have plants with four loops and four steam generators, and now we have plants, also big plants, with only two steam generators with two loops. So there are different solutions. So this is a typical configuration of the reactor coolant system. So here, coming to the initial drawing, you see the coolant system is this one that is the primary coolant system, the one that is in red. So vessel, part of the steam generators, primary pump, pressurizer, And of course, the pressurizer is a system itself, because a system to control the pressure of the fluid and so on. This is very, very schematic what is represented here. And then we have the safety valve can or have to decrease the pressure of the system. And then there's a tank where this steam can be condensed. Then we have, as I said before, this is a system to remove the heat, the residual heat when the reactor is shut down state, so we cannot remove through the steam generator. And there are here two circuits. This is generically called intermediate cooling system. And this system normally in different technologies assume different names. Quite common name is for this intermediate is component cooling water system. And the second, the system that interfacing with the ultimate sink is very often called essential system water cooling or something similar. Okay, but that is not relevant. What you have to have in mind, here there are the chain to exchange the heat is quite complex. It's not just one. So there are several loops that is done on purpose for confining the radioactivities mainly. And you understand if you have to duplicate one to make a redundant system of this chain, you have to duplicate everything if you want to make independent. This is done sometimes in good design, but not always. In some design, they have a common system. The initial part of the chain is duplicated, but the final part that goes to the ultimate sink is unique. So it's not really a complete independent the installation of the implementation of two complete separated independent systems. But there is even worse, I would say, that some systems that are designed to remove the heat in normal operation in shutdown can be used also as a safety function in the accident. So they are safety systems. So you see, this is one case where the independence of level of the defense in depth is really badly implemented, because safety system should not have function in normal operation. But these are existing reactor, many of these are designed in this way, but there is one consideration to do about the classification. If a system has two functions, one in accident condition and one in normal operation, should be classified according to the most demanding condition. So it's classified and designed as a safety system, even if it's used in normal operation. So this should be clear. But it's not the best practice to implement our requirement on independence of level of the defense in depth. Then here in green we have the emergency core cooling system. That is, these are the system to deal with loss of coolant accidents. So if we have a break in the primary coolant system, so we lose the primary coolant, so we need to cool the core with an independent source of water and independent system. So we have, normally we have accumulators. These are those that act first, very high pressure, and they inject very quickly water in the core, but they can inject only the water contained in the tank, because the tank is normally a large tank, and there are several, it's not only one. Normally there is a series of this, and there is a separation between the water and the gas. Here, the gas is compressed, it's pushing the water. Once we open the valve, it's pushing the water. But when the tank is empty, it's empty. That's no way, the water is finished. Then we have to rely on system, in this case an active system, so we have tank where you suck the water from, and then we have system different according to different accidents or different moments of the accident mitigation, high pressure or low pressure pump to inject the water. Okay, and then here, this is the chemical control system and the inventory control system. So these curves is, I'm sure most of you have seen this curve, but just to remind you what are the physical conditions of the fluid, of the water, inside the primary and secondary loop of a PWR or the primary circuit of a BWR. Here, there is, for example, let me come here because otherwise I don't see. This is the case of the PWR. So we have the primary system here, the secondary system. You can see that the pressure in the primary system is around 15.2 megapascal. That means little more than 150 atmospheres, if you are more familiar. So this is the operating pressure of a PWR. And you see the temperature here is 288. This is the inlet temperature. And this, the temperature outside of the core is around 324. And can change a little bit. This value can be different, but cannot be very much different. May I ask you why? Why cannot be 350 or 400 the temperature, the exit temperature in a PWR? Sorry? Yes, because you wouldn't have water, you would have steam. It would not be a pressurized water, but a pressurized steam reactor, of course. So, unfortunately, in this technology, there are these limits. There are the properties of the water. And we cannot go very up on the temperature. That is, of course, is a reflect on the efficiency of the thermal cycle. But I mean, these are basic concepts. And then you see here what are the condition of pressure and temperature in the condenser. And for the secondary steam, you see we are operating a pressure of steam about 7 megapascals, 6.9, and the temperature in this case is 227 and 285 temperature. So it's a quite low temperature for a steam cycle. No? So the efficiency cannot be very high because for the physics. But anyway, that is just to give you an idea for what are really the values of the key parameters. If we move to the BWR, the pressure is not very much different. It's 7.3, and this is the range of the temperature. And of course, we reach the saturation line, and because we produce the water is boiling and inside the core, and we have steam practically exit of the core, or a mixture of steam and water, of course, is a biphase situation. So what are the specific requirements? As I remember yesterday, I said in our requirement, we have some general requirement that apply to all systems. And then in section 6 of SSR2/1, we have dedicated requirements for each important system. We have requirement for the core, requirement for the coolant system, requirement for the containment, and so on. So I recall briefly what we say there. So the requirement 47, design of reactor coolant system. The components of the reactor coolant system for nuclear power plant shall be designed and constructed so that the risk of faults due to inadequate quality of materials, inadequate design standard, insufficient capability for inspection, adequate quality of material is minimized. So practically this says the primary coolant system should be designed very high standard. So that reflect should be classified in a higher class and then designed, manufactured, and operated at the high standard level. So the pipe wall connected to the pressure boundary, because of course there are many lines, many other systems that are connected to the primary coolant system of the reactor coolant system for the nuclear power plant shall be equipped with adequate isolation devices, so it's possible to isolate if it's necessary, to limit any loss of radioactive fluid, primary coolant, and to prevent the loss of coolant through interfacing systems. The design of the reactor coolant pressure boundary shall be such that flows are very unlikely to be initiated. Flows, I mean, flows in the material, in the thickness of the piping or the vessel, for example. And any flows that are initiated would propagate in a regime of high resistance to unstable fracture and to rapid crack propagation, thereby permitting the timely detection of flows. I will add some information on this when we are talking about the vessel, but this is, of course, maybe many of you, some of you are specialists in fracture mechanics, so you know exactly what we are talking about. This is a quite complex science, how the flows propagate inside the material, different temperature, and how they are influenced by the temperature, by the other characteristics of the material, of the neutron irradiation, and so on. But the requirement reminds us that we have to take care of all this situation, and we have also to work in a regime and in a situation where if there is a flow, flow inside the material, this is not propagating. Or if it's propagating, it's not propagating fast. Maybe it's growing, but we can keep under control. This is just to remind you about design margin. This is a simpler, is a very schematic, but is representing the same concept that Tony showed you yesterday in a more complex diagram, just to indicate the concept. So we have, this can be, you know, we have a pressure, we want to see, we have, of course, a working pressure, operating pressure in the pipe, and there is, of course, there is a pressure that is causing the destruction of the piping. So you want to know what is the margin we can rely on. So we have, there is a value of the parameter that is determined with realistic assumption. But also this value, for many, many reasons, can be affected by some uncertainties. So we have to be aware of this. If we determine the same parameters, but using in our calculation a conservative approach, we determine a different value. And for example, this is the value we determine. And there are some limits established by the safety authority that add some margin to this. Or it depends which parameter, or they deduct some value, which parameters we are dealing with. And there is another value, for example, in case of the pressure, a value that can produce a cleavage effect, so can produce the rupture of the component and suddenly generate consequences very serious. Can I ask you, some of you, to explain what is a cleavage effect in general? What do you understand when we say cleavage effect? Because we have to understand the terms that we are using. Tony already mentioned yesterday, but can be misinterpreted there, also this concept. Okay, go ahead, please. Yes, so that means you are in a situation where a small variation of a parameter, or more parameter, can cause a big difference in the consequences. You know? It's like when you are walking, this is called cliff edge, because it's like when you are walking on you are walking on a cliff. You know, if a, And this is a cliff, and you are walking here in this direction. Let's put like this. You're walking here. If you stay very close to this cliff, and you just lose equilibrium a little bit, you fall down. If you are here further than this, you lose your equilibrium a little bit, nothing happens. If you are here, you are even safer because you can even move and jump, you don't fall. So the distance that we have from the cliff is practically the margin, or related to the margin in a very intuitive way. Here the margin is this, here the margin is this, here the margin is this. And this concept can be translated in other parameters, that is not distance, can be pressure, can be... And we use this term in our safety standard very often, in particular referring to seismic events, to external events, when we say we have to include large margin to avoid cliffage effect. That means if the acceleration of your earthquake is a little higher than what you assumed in your design basis, the reaction of the plant is good, nothing happens, so you are protected. And the earthquake, normally the earthquake is not causing very severe cliffage effects, because it's very, with the earthquake, if you have an earthquake that is growing in intensity, you don't fail all your components at once. Maybe you start one component failed, and if the earthquake goes higher, another component, so on. But in case of the flooding, the cliffage effect is very drastic, because if you have a barrier, until you don't reach the barrier, you don't have any leak on the other side. But if you increase a little bit, then you flood the other side. So it's very important. So this is something to keep in mind. A very intuitive concept, but we use this word cliffage effect extensively in our requirement. And for margin, on margin there is literature, so you can read many, many publications. In our safety standard, we don't make difference between design margins or safety margins. We call margins in general, okay? We use with the same the meaning, safety margin and design margin. So the requirement for the design, the design of the reactor coolant system, the design of reactor coolant system shall be such as to ensure that plant states in which components of the reactor coolant pressure boundary could exhibit embrittlement are avoided. You know what embrittlement is. So then I will explain a little. That is something also, this is very important because it has very strong consequences on the design and consequences on the life of the plant. Because embrittlement is really mainly caused by neutron irradiation. Not only, but mainly by neutron irradiation. The design of the components contained inside the reactor coolant pressure boundary, such as the pumps, the pump impellers, the valves, paths, shall be such as to minimize the likelihood of failure and consequential damage to other components of the primary coolant system that are important to safety. In all operational state and design basis, accident condition, with due allowance made for deterioration that might occur in service. Practically, we say that we have to design high quality and take into consideration all the possible phenomena and the loads that we can consider. That, let's go this to this. I would like to spend just a few words. I'm sure this is a basic engineering, so most of you have seen these things. And who has seen these things? The variation of the energy that is necessary to break a sample of material in function of the temperature. What is called resilience. The resilience is a property of material that is the energy you need to break a sample of this material. Have you seen this? Who can come here and explain to the colleagues this curve? I mean, it's not an exam. It's just, well, if you don't, I will try to do something. But I mean, this is a phenomenon that is very important, especially for the vessel, because the vessel, especially in the area facing the core, is subject to irradiation of high energy neutrons, fast neutrons. Of course, there are shieldings inside. There is protection. Of course, there is a layer of water. But some of these neutrons, and they change the property of this material. If you see, if you consider, this is just a typical behavior for steel, the upper part. But let's see, okay, and you see here what is plotted in this curve is the energy versus the temperature. The energy is the energy that is necessary to break specimen of this material. Of course, this is a standardized test. It's called the Sharpe test. It is theoretically is very, very simple. It's still used, but doesn't cover all the situations. Then I will tell you why. What do we measure here? We have a pendulum, hopla, sorry for this. We have a pendulum that is at this elevation, so it has this potential energy. We put this specimen here, and this is prepared in a particular way, standardized size, and in the code for the material, you find all these characteristics, and there's a sort of intake here to facilitate the rupture. We release the pendulum, and the pendulum breaks the material and reach another elevation that's less than this. Of course, the difference in elevation is proportional to the energy. So that is, and so we can measure the energy that is necessary to break the, and we plot this energy. We make different tests at different temperatures. And we plot this energy, and there is a typical behavior. You see, if we stay above this temperature, higher temperature, we need rather higher energy to break the sample. Then there is this transition area here, where the energy is decreasing very fast, and then if you could live here, if you operate at the very lower temperature, you can break with little energy. And here we say the material has a ductile behavior. Here is a fragile or brittle behavior. That is very important, because if you have a pressurized component, and you work in this area, the resistance of the materials is much higher. If you go here, the behavior, you need very little energy to propagate a flow that is inside the material. And the material breaks like a glass, that is the extreme brittle material. Of course, the steel doesn't behave like this, but similarly. Yeah? So this is how the material behaves normally. This is a characteristic of the steel, is always like this. But when you irradiate this material, you have a switch So this curve you see here moves down. And the more is the irradiation, this curve moves down and moves also in this direction. That means, in general, the energy that you need to break and propagate a flow is much lower than here. But the temperature, also the temperature, where you have this transition, maybe you heard the term and dT, nil ductility temperature. So is the temperature in this range. That is separating these two areas, ductile behavior and brittle behavior. So if you look at the values, these values here are quite realistic for a steel used in the vessel. So you saw that the vessel start, of course, with fresh material. After so many years of irradiation, the temperature that you have this transition to the brittle approach values above the room temperature. So you can really inject like Tony mentioned this morning, if you are not careful, you can inject a water at the temperature that brings the vessel in this range. And you have the risk of a catastrophic rupture of the vessel because the vessel is pressurized, and probably in the vessel there are some flaws inside. And this change in property of the vessel is one of the main parameters that is determine the life of a nuclear power plant, because as Tony said, the vessel cannot be changed. And you have to work also with some margin. You cannot risk this. You have to be far from this. And so this is becoming important, particularly for the vessel, for old material with some thickness. But it's important also for piping, all other components. So it's something to keep in mind, because there are some accidents that have been studied, analyzed because of the injection of cold water in these old components. Tony this morning mentioned the problem caused by different temperature, by delta T's, but there are also problems due to the radiation. So this is something is important, is an important factor in the primary coolant, because don't forget the vessel is part of the primary, it contains the core, but it's part of the primary coolant system. And it is a component. If it fails, there is nothing we can do. It's really a catastrophic consequence. So it's something to practically eliminate. So the analysis of the behavior of the material is one way to reach the practical elimination of this situation. So I spent a little time on this, but I think it's worthwhile. So here, for example, I have listed some, because I found this listed for VVR, but it is the same for other reactors. What has been done in modern reactor to extend the life from 40 years to 60 years, because this is attempt dictated, of course, from the economy of the plant. You want to use the plant for longer time, so that the cost per year is going down. And now the modern plants are designed for 60 years. You see, all the factors that have been considered, practically this is a simplified list. Probably there are more things than this. So there is a new program of surveillance of specimen, placement of irradiated stainless steel directly in the reactor vessel, directly on the reactor vessel wall. Oh, I forgot to tell you that during the life of the vessel, the property of the vessel are tested, so we should know at which level of embrittlement we are. This is done putting inside the vessel sample of the same material that they have the same irradiation of the walls of the vessel, and periodically when there is a refueling maintenance, we take this sample out and we make the test with the Sharpie, and so we know in which situation. I think this is now is normal practice. It's not done everywhere and was not done in the past, so we didn't know what the situation was, but now I think it's normal practice. And this is also established in the code, so there are rules very well defined. Then there are, of course, some technological solutions like the limitation of the nickel or the property of materials, limitation of harmful impurities in the basic material, metals and welds, modernization of manufacturing technique, decrease of neutron flux to the reactor vessel, of course, to use the flux, the fluence in the in the material you have to put some shields, and of course the very sensitive areas are those areas, for example, where the weldings are. So a good technique, I think, almost everywhere now is to avoid, well, if the vessel is realized in several parts, is to avoid the welding in the active zone of the core. So should not be welding, or welding means also penetrations. They shouldn't be penetration normally, they are also welded. So this is, of course, there are several solutions that are implemented. So, and then increase of the control reliability of fluence and reactor vessel. So they see this is a value, these are realistic value for this. So we have an idea of which range of temperature. We are really talking about temperature very close to the operating in some situation. So the decrease in NDT, so that when we switch the temperature, when we switch from ductile to brittle behavior, of the nozzle zone, the nozzle and the penetration zone core barrels, to minus 35 degrees centigrade at the beginning of life and plus 50 at the end. You see what is the switch in temperature? Is 85 degrees. So from the beginning of life to the end of life of the vessel, the transition temperature moves 85 degrees, so it's a big range, so it's something very important. So we continue with the requirement 48, the overpressure protection of the reactor coolant pressure boundary. Every time we have something pressurized, we have a system to control the pressure and to relieve the pressure, of course. Overpressure protection of the reactor coolant pressure boundary provision shall be made to ensure that the operation of pressure relief devices will protect the pressure boundary of the reactor coolant systems against overpressure and will not lead to the release of radioactive material from the nuclear power plant directly to the environment. So every time you have a pressurized system, you have to have some valves, safety valves, that are necessary in case the pressure increases for any reason and you cannot control. Of course, there are systems to control the pressure, but if the control system is not capable to control or is not working correctly and the pressure exceeds an established value, your relief valve open and discharge the valve inside the container, discharge the fluid inside the containment, either in a tank or in the atmosphere of the containment. Requirement 49, inventory of the coolant. Provision shall be made for controlling the inventory, temperature, and pressure of the reactor coolant to ensure that the specified design limits are not exceeded in any operational state of the nuclear power plant with due account taken of volumetric changes and leakages. So also this, I think, is something very, very easy to understand. So, but you see, every time you have one of these requirements, there are several functions then you have to implement. And so your system is becoming more and more complex because you keep adding system to system to system. So you start for a single pipe with a single pump and a steam generator and keep adding hundreds of other components and to preserve the structure integrity of the reactor coolant system boundary by keeping in conjunction with the reactor scram the pressure below the design limit specified for different category of postulating events. So this is the function, we are now in the function of overpressure protection system. Of course, it's a system, it has some functions, we have to identify this function and then put system to implement. Successfully this function. Another function is to ensure the protection of the reactor coolant system structure integrity in case of ATWS. Of course, if you have a transient that requires the scram of the reactor and the trip doesn't work for any reason, you understand that the power is still generated and so the pressure if you, for example, lost the secondary side and you don't achieve the proper trip of the reactor, the pressure, of course, is increasing. But 80 WS is a transient that is part of our design basis. So the plan should be designed to cope with this situation. There are different ways to cope, but the plant can face this situation, either with intrinsic characteristic of the plant or with additional systems to shut down the plant. To provide protection against an acceptable load combination of high pressure and low temperature when the reactor coolant system is operated at low temperature, protection of RCS equipment with material or less ductility at low temperature. So this is the same topic that we have already discussed. So what the function of the depressurization system? This, I want to spend a few words on this because it's something important and particularly important now that we have introduced the design extension condition in the design. So the function depends on the type of reactor. So we distinguish between PWRs and BWRs. For PWRs, for the practical elimination of the phenomena associated with high-pressure melt ejection, in case of severe accident, PWRs should be equipped with a fast depressurization of the primary circuit system, manually actuated. So that means that in addition to the system to control the pressure, in addition to the system, the safety valve that discharge in case you have an excursion of pressure, we want to have the ability to fast depressurize the primary circuit. Why we want this and when? What is the because we do this as extreme, the latest measure to deal with the big accident. If we have a design basis accident, a large loss of coolant, large break in the primary coolant, and we for some reason. We see the operator can realize that the emergency core cooling system are not working because some problem, loss of power. So we know that we are going to a core melt situation. The core melt situation cannot be avoided because the core is still producing energy. The decay heat, we don't remove this heat. So what can we do? We know that we are going to a severe accident. So we choose to depressurize the reactor very fast because this first produces a cooling. But second, we go to a severe accident that we can cope with. Because with a severe accident in high pressure conditions, we can have some phenomena that we cannot cope with. A typical is the direct containment heating. If the vessel breaks because of the core melt in high pressure, this material is ejected at high pressure in the atmosphere of the containment, exchange the energy with the gas in the containment very quickly and can pressurize the containment. The containment can explode. So this is a phenomenon we want to avoid. To avoid this, the only possibility we have is to depressurize. You have a core melt, but it's in a low pressure condition, and in low pressure condition, we can cope with a rather conventional containment structure and so on. So this is a way to eliminate, to practically eliminate high pressure situation in core melt. So the system, the modern reactor, have this additional system installed just for this purpose. Of course, it's a system for design extension condition, but really in a very extreme situation when there is nothing else to do. We have all the we detect the symptoms in the plant and we know that we are going to core melt for sure, there is nothing we can do, it's better to depressurize. So in this case, the operator decides and open these valves. For example. For example, yes, yes. Yes, right. Of course, if the system is already depressurized, doesn't make sense to open again. You're right. I said something not precise. But also, if you think also the heat removal system, the residual heat removal system, is in some reactor considered part of the ECCS, so is an emergency core coolant system. So, yeah, but that means, you are in a situation you cannot do anything to control the pressure. You don't remove the heat and the pressure is going up. And it's clear if the pressure doesn't grow if the circuit is open already. What is, sorry? It's very low. We showed yesterday, this probability is in the range of 10 minus 6, this range. If you look at the table, what was, we showed the frequency of different plant states. So this is very, like you said, is a very low probability, but is below 10 minus 6. But who knows exactly when it is, when you are going to this range.
Because actually we have discussion of Russian plasma system, plastic or strategic system, but
yeah.
This is impossible. So,
if they say so, nothing is impossible, unfortunately. Eh? Even to have four molten core at the same time was just impossible before. And this feature now is already implemented in some design. Of course, the probability that you reach this situation is different in different plants. Because this is the result of all the system that you have in the plant. If you have a very high redundancy in the heat removal chains and they are completely separated and with a completely independent source of power, using diverse technologies. You can exclude this. You can say, basically, I don't have to address this situation because my plant takes care of this. But this, so it depends on the design, of course. Then for you see, this is a safety feature. The safety feature is here. This is important to remember. Is a safety feature. This is is automatic switch after some time that is not used. I cannot start again. No. A sec, this is now supposed to be on. It's red light. Push. Oh, it's getting weaker and weaker, so that is the point. So you see here, now it's getting back. The safety feature designed to practically eliminate direct containment heating for DCA, direct containment heating, is this one. For BWRs, the BWRs are already equipped with a system. The current BWR are equipped with a system for fast depressurization, normally it's called ADS, automatic depressurization system, because they use the depressurization system to deal with some design basis accidents. In order to allow the operation of the low pressure system, they have to depressurize the reactor, otherwise the low pressure system cannot function. So, you see, in the BWR, practically the same system allow the operation of the low-pressure coolant injection function is a safety system designed for mitigation of design basis accidents. So in the PWR, is designed for this very rare, very ultimate design extension condition. Here is designed to operate in normal InDesign basis accidents. So they have to keep in mind these differences. The pressurization system, what it looks like for some reactor, safety valve, and so on. So, requirement for the design of the reactor coolant system, requirement for the cleanup, requirement 50. Adequate facility shall be provided nuclear power plant for the removal from the reactor coolant of radioactive substances, including activated corrosion products and fission products deriving from the fuel and not radioactive substances. Of course, you are familiar with this during the operation. You produce some cruds, you remove some material, and this material is activated. And for some reason, this material can accumulate in some areas and create high radiation level areas. So you have to take this in consideration, and you have constantly to remove this material and clean the water. The capability of the necessary plant system shall be based on the specified design limit on permissible leakage of the fuel with a conservative margin to ensure that the plant can be operated with a level of circuit activity that is as low as reasonably practicable, and to ensure that the requirements are met for radioactive releases to be as low as reasonably achievable and below the authorized limits on discharges. Yes, this is linked to the what we said yesterday for radiation protection of the operator. So we have seen this already. I don't know why this is here. So this is here because we talk about this cleaning up system. So it's shown here in the left side. The requirement 51, removal of residual heat from the reactor core, this is another important system, means shall be provided for the removal of residual heat from the reactor core in the shutdown states of a nuclear power plant, such the design limits of the fuel, the reactor coolant pressure boundary, and the structure important to safety are not exceeded. So I have some example here. The system we are talking about now is this. Is this yellow one? And of course, in the PWR, there are different approaches. Now I don't want to go into details this because this is very design specific. But in the PWR, if you have the steam generator available, the steam generator is the best system to remove the heat, so you don't use it when it's possible, especially when you have still high pressure in the primary circuit. You cannot operate in several cases the heat removal system because it starts working only with the pressure, because it's a system designed for lower pressure. It's not designed for the pressure of the coolant system. So you tend to remove the heat to depressurize using the steam generator, and some design have the possibility have an auxiliary feed water system for this situation, and this is called auxiliary, so it's not a safety system, but in some design this auxiliary feed water system, so the system that feeds the steam generator with water to produce steam, is a safety system, so it's a function of a safety system, so this depends on the strategy. And in the PWR, in some situation, you have the possibility to discharge the steam directly to the atmosphere because the steam in the steam generator is clean, it's not contaminated, so you can feed with the emergency feed water system and discharge into the atmosphere. And then when you have reached the condition to which the RHR system can start working, you operate this, and then this can operate for longer term, and you transfer the heat to the heat sink. So emergency cooling of the reactor core when we are in the accident means to cooling the reactor core shall be provided to restore and maintain the cooling of the fuel under accident conditions. at the nuclear power plant, even if the integrity of the pressure boundary of the primary coolant system is not maintained. So we are in case of loss of coolant accidents, so we are explicitly addressing the emergency core cooling systems. And this, the means provided for cooling of the reactor core shall be such as to ensure that limiting the parameter and the cladding integrity of the fuel, everything that already Tony mentioned a few times, I think, avoid possible chemical reaction. That means what we have in mind is the oxidation of the cladding and the production of hydrogen. The effectiveness of the means of cooling the reactor core compensates for possible changes in the fuel and internal geometry of the reactor core. Cooling of the reactor core will be ensured for a long time. Design features such as leak detection systems, and we are moving another topic now, appropriate interconnection and capability for isolation and suitable redundancy and diversity shall be provided to fulfill the requirement above. So these are specific aspects of the design of this system. This already we mentioned several times. Here, as an example, because you know, in our safety standard, there are no numbers. In the safety guide, some cases we have numbers, but we are not allowed really to use number in our safety standards because this number can be different and our different from member state to member state, and so we should write things that are applicable practically to all member states. So this makes our life difficult. So if we have to go to some really acceptance criteria and give numbers, we have to refer to other standards or practices of other countries. But this I mention here because this is adopted practically by everybody. Comes from originally from NRC, but now is wide use. Everybody, I think, is using the same criteria. So the peak clad temperature that we are allowed to reach in a design basis accident condition, maximum is 1,200 degrees C. The maximum cladding oxidation, the calculated total oxidation of the cladding, shall nowhere exceed 0.17 times the total cladding thickness before the oxidation. Then we have criteria for the maximum hydrogen generation. Of course, the hydrogen generation is related to the oxidation because it's the main mechanism to create hydrogen. So, something on the coolant geometry. The coolant, the core should be still coolable. And this is Tony mentioned this morning, long-term cooling after any calculated successful initial operation of the ECCS, the calculated core temperature shall be maintained at an acceptably low value and decay heat shall be removed for extended period of time required by the long-lived radioactivity remaining in the core. Okay, so this is an example of a practical value. Then here I have some drawings that apply that to a little more modern reactor rather than what I selected at the beginning. So here you see the typical reactor coolant system of two-loop reactors. You see the system to depressurize the reactor, the two loops, and here there are the safety injection system with accumulators and pumps a different value of pressure to face different accident or different moment of the action. Here we have a system to remove the heat, the spray inside the atmosphere, the containment, and recirculate the water. So it's the containment heat removal system. And here we have what we have mentioned before, the emergency feed water system. So this second possibility to feed. This is the main feed water that comes from the condenser. This is the auxiliary, and the steam can be discharged to the atmosphere through this system of valves. Then I don't know if there is something else. Yes. So these are this is the cooling chain with the loops and that go to the ultimate heat sink. And what is this? This is the core, the volume, and chemical control system. Yeah, this is another example, but you can find plenty of these examples. And then you see the more you go into detail, and the complexity is increasing. And in reality, the systems are very complex. Yeah, this is for a typical passive system like AP1000. And that is a final consideration, how to see how the design is affected by the safety analysis. Of course, you start from a design, maybe it can be a preliminary design. This doesn't work anymore. You model your plant for your computer code. This is a typical modeling of a PWR in a computer code like a RELAP, this code for the fluid analysis. Then you determine the characteristic, the value of the parameter that you have for different accident, and then you can correct or implement other system in your design. So the final design is a result of many cycles of analysis and fixing and improving the systems. So I think that's it. So this is just the summary, what we discussed. The design of reactor coolant system associated system vary considerably among world's population nuclear power plant, because we are entering in the specific technological solution. So we have to deal one by one. The results of the safety assessment are a relevant part of the safety analysis report. This, because we have a dedicated chapter for the coolant system, normally chapter 5, the coolant system alone. Then we have, in another chapter, we have the emergency core cooling systems in the US standard 1.7. Regulatory guide 1.7 is in chapter 6. It's called engineering features, so part is dedicated to the core cooling system and part is dedicated to the containment, and so on. So these are spread in different chapters, but all these systems are addressed in the safety analysis report. The design of the reactor coolant system associated system of modern reactors is affected by the latest design requirement, independence of level defense in depth in particular, and the introduction of the design extension condition, so including the severe accident in the design and the result of multiple failures, even in safety system, more than one failure in the safety system. And by the extension of the life of the plant entity, what we said before, because now the trend is to operate the plant for a longer time. This is finished. It was a long discussion, a long concept, but nobody's sleeping, so that's a very good sign. Maybe the food was not so heavy today. Okay. Why one is better than two?
Yeah.
I don't know. This is what you have more. I don't understand. How can one system be more reliable than two systems in two different situations?
Because the one used for the normal operation, you have to shut down the pump and to stop at the other pumps for the accident.
Okay, you can decide case by case, But I think the good solution is to have independent system for independent function. Of course, you have to consider all the situation. You can have a probabilistic study. If you conclude that your solution is better, you can implement that. But I have my doubts in principle, but I am convinced that you can demonstrate everything with PSA. You just You just fix what you want to achieve. You make a PSA. You tune some values. You can demonstrate what. No, this is exaggerating a little bit. I hope there are no PSA experts because I don't want to. Yeah, but of course, at the end is the analysis that dictates what is the best solution. The best solution. But you know, if you lose a system in normal operation and you need the same system in an accident caused by the failure of that system, what do you do then? So this is the point. Because the system in normal operation can fail and cause an accident. And you want to cope with accident with the system that has already failed. So this, well, then okay. If you have four trains, you have four systems, yes. It depends, of course, you know, with the probabilistic safety analysis, you can make this decision. Of course, you can increase the number of trains. You can feed these trains with independent source of energy, for example. So there are different solutions. There is no single solution. So also the way you can realize the independence of the levels can be different. For example, using different power sources is already a way to achieve this independence. You are going into the direction of increasing independence. I think I don't know, let's see, which slide was this? The first one? Oh, the first one. Let's see if I can. Something can be also wrong, eh? If you don't, it's not. The science. So, where did you? Which slide? You see, the first is. Maybe it was in the pressurization thing, huh? He was and this one back. This one.
Over pressure protection system. Last two bullets.
Yeah, I mentioned before, the overpressure system is a system that. Is like the safety valves, no? Or can be the relief valve to control the pressure. This fast depressurization system is this dedicated system to severe accident that we mentioned. That is what I intended to say there. It's just the system to depressurize to avoid high pressure core melt situation. Okay? And also in this case, some design, they tend to use the same valves with the two different functions. But also this is, yes, so then also, you know, when you are using the valves for different plant states, maybe the valve, they have to operate with different condition of the fluids. So you have to qualify this valve for the most severe situation. So it's not immediate that if a valve is good as a safety valve, can be also good for fast depressurization. So, but the overpressure protection system is an automatic system, always. If you see the threshold, it opens the valve. The depressurization system for this purpose is manually operated. It's the operator that decides when he has all the indication that there is nothing else to do. So cannot be exactly the same system or can have some components in common, but also this is a bad practice.
Avoid
Yeah, yeah. Yes, from a function also this is true, yes, of course. This depressurization system is a feature for DEC, for design extension condition with Cormel. Not
for sphere extension.
Well, if you assume that you are a core, you have a molten core, or you are going to reach a situation of molten core, you are in a severe accident. We call severe accident those involving the core. But when you decide to depressurize, maybe the core is not completely molten or part, because the core is not instantaneous, so the melting of the core takes some time. Huh? You do everything you can do, but when you realize that you cannot remove the heat anymore and you are going to melt the core, that is what you do.
Marco, let me explain it in a very, very simple way.
Yes, explain in a more simple way.
Because why do we need that trans-depressurization system during accident condition? Accident, severe accident condition, you have the core mass. At the time moment when the reactor vessel fails, there should be high pressure, because at that time the direct containment heating will occur. So it will be an explosion. We have low pressure in the system when the reactor vessel fails, then it will simply separate from the one part from the other without any explosion. So then we can already avoid large releases and the damage of the container. Okay? So that's why we need the depressurization system for the accident condition. The overpressure protection system is a different system. It is simply prevent the overpressurization of the
Failure of the main pressure boundary, yes.
Which can cause damage of the reactor. Okay. So these are two different systems. One is for landings, accidents, and normal operation. The other is for severe accident condition. Okay. So the most important thing here is at the moment of the vessel damage due to overheating of the core mass, you should have low pressure in the system. Otherwise, it will be exploded. And we don't know the consequences. The consequences are unpredictable. Therefore, we want to avoid it. So this is what the depressurization system is needed.
The normal
safety valves can be used, but they have different functions. So the normal safety valve is to protect against the overpressurization. So usually they are automatic or so, but the depressurization should be intentional. So you have to do it manually. Therefore, you have to have a system which can be operated manually. And it is easier to separate these two functions with these two different systems than to incorporate these two functions by one system. Because that will complicate the situation, complicate the design. And also, you will have to avoid the unintentional depressurization during normal operation. Okay. So, if you incorporate these two functions into one function, hopefully by one system, you have to be careful with the design, because it may happen that some
Normally, yes.
Normally, it depends on the design.
Because if you don't put in the pressurizer, no, you have to put a new penetration, either in the vessel or in the piping. So this also, so normally, all the solution I've seen, they are in the pressurizer, but in principle, it can be also somewhere else. Yeah, bad designs, let's say.
And even I know that some new designs also try to incorporate it, but some of the regulations require to separate these two functions. This thing in Hungary, we separate by the regulation these two functions. And we require have both the full.
And how do you operate the pressurization system with the same DC power, the same compressed air? How do you operate this? Or you have a dedicated system in Hungary? Because, you know, one thing is separate the valves. You have two different set of valves, but the valves are only part of the system. Because the valve you have manually operate, you need the system to operate. It can be compressed air, can be electric power, DC power, whatever. So when if you want a complete separation, you have to separate also the source of power.
So this question did not appear before for the order plans because we concentrated on the design basis accident. We did not take care of the situation when the core has already damaged. The core damage was massive. Now, in the new designs, there is a requirement to deal with the core damages as well as within the design in order to avoid large releases.
Okay, thanks. Other things? But I think we are already 10 minutes late. Yeah, probably it's better to. Then we can have some question at the end of the session, in the discussion.